I'm super excited to welcome you to the Within You podcast, where we explore the unknowing, the liminal space, as you and I and everyone else in this world navigates between now and what's next. Yo soy Viviana Carrasco. I'm a wisdom teacher and mindset mentor based right here in Funky Town, which is Fort Worth, Texas. Hello, y'all. This is a very exciting episode for me. So exciting because this is the guest that it has been the toughest to book. Okay. And this is my first in real life interview. So without further ado, I would like to welcome my beloved David Carrasco.
Hey, what's up?
I'm just beside myself with this interview. So I am fascinated with transitions of identity, with change that is triggered on the outside that then forces us, or we choose to, you know, suffering or choice to change. One of the things that fascinates me about you, David, and I actually really admire, is how you navigate those transitions. And you've been navigating those since 2011, when you retired from the military. And I've seen you, you know, evolve your identity over the last 30 years of our marriage. But what I'm here to interview about is you becoming a mountain biker, because I saw that evolution.
Whoop, whoop.
Let's go ahead and give a shout out to your YouTube channel.
That would be Dave C. from DC Productions.
Behind the bar.
That's right.
So that's what I admire and what I wanted to bring, and why I wanted to bring you on. Talk to my audience and to those that are also interested in navigating transitions smoothly. Tell me, what's your secret? How did you move from, what was that journey like? I saw it from my end, but internally, how did you become a mountain biker?
Wow. So just peel the Band-Aid off right at the beginning, huh?
Yep.
You know, you briefly talked about transition. I think a lot of it has to do with the environment, you know, as far as your surroundings. But I'm going to be honest with you, you know, first transition from the military to full-time civilian was pretty tough for me. You know, being a soldier, leader, mentor in that environment, I was excited about taking on the next chapter. You know, what I didn't know what it exactly it entailed. But along the way, I think you've referenced it in the past as like chasing the fire. So it was one of those things that I knew that I wanted to get involved, be physical, you know, not the same stuff we did in the military, you know, the push-up, sit-ups, and run. So just getting on a bike just kind of opened me up and kind of freed my mind. And then from then on, it's just now we're gone from riding to leading a couple groups and becoming a certified mountain bike mechanic.
Yes, there's a whole setup in the garage with 12 bikes, is it?
You can never have enough bikes, trust me.
Well, speaking of the number of bikes we have, topic for another episode in a different podcast. One of the things that I see people doing and myself doing, honestly, this is sort of a confession, I guess. Instead of committing to doing the work and showing up with intensity, some people try to buy the result with either technology or tools. And I find myself doing that when something's holding me back. Personally, with the podcast, I mean, I won't tell you how many microphones I have.
That's funny.
I hide them in my closet so you can't see them. But how do you feel about the difference between showing up and doing the work, you know, making that commitment, and just trying to buy your result? What's your opinion of that, or how do you see it?
Well, it's funny you talk about technology, because you know, the mountain bike community has evolved into, you know, the high techy stuff. But I think it's having that baseline, you know, first getting on the bike and then acclimate it, and then, you know, learning about your endurance, you know, how to ride the bike. Yeah, you know, we've ridden bikes all our lives, you know, but when you get on a mountain bike, you know, it's got some different skills that you need to, you know, have. But as far as the tech, you know, you go down that road, just like your microphones, oh, I got to have the best tech on the bike, you know, the best equipment. But in reality, when you go back, you're pushing the pedals, you know. It was getting that baseline, knowing like, hey, I really like doing this. I like just being out in the environment. So when I say mountain biking, to me, it's like I've described it, it's like therapy. So you get out there, you're on the trail, you're not thinking about stuff back home. You're not thinking about, you know, did I do this? Did I take the trash out? You know, you're just riding, not knowing if the trail is going to turn left or right. So you're focused in the moment. And that's what really I love about it. It gives me a peace of mind.
So what I hear you saying is that regardless of what we're into, we can all get lost in buying the tech, but it's about showing up for the ride.
Absolutely. I totally agree with that.
Cool. I'm glad you agree, since, you know, I'm married to you and stuff.
28 years. I've learned to agree a long time ago.
Well, actually, before you said yes to this, before you actually, you know, walked up to the mic, I was looking in the back of my mind, you know, the little filing cabinet. And if we count the years that we were dating, it was 86. So that's 30 something years.
Yeah, that's quite a long time, right?
A lot of our lives.
Well, when you say, you know, you've been doing this for what, 6 years?
I have been podcasting for 6 years.
Yeah. So, you know, I kind of went through that whole separation thing where, you know, this is your thing. You know, I want to be behind and support you, allowing you to buy the mics and stuff.
Allowing.
Yeah, just kidding. You know, this is your thing. And, you know, and I've seen it grown from the beginning, from a scratch piece of paper to where it's evolved now. And it's truly amazing just hearing comments, you know, reading about it or people's feedback. And, you know, so I didn't want to jump in. And, you know, you say the hardest person to interview.
To book.
And it's not that. It was just giving you your time, your space, and letting you grow with that. You know, same thing. You know, we're here to support. I mean, I just got you out here a couple weeks ago on the mountain bike doing stuff that I was like, wow. So it works both ways.
Yeah, I never imagined I'd be doing downhill.
Yeah, no.
I'm pretty good at it.
Well, yeah, hats off to you.
I don't know if you agreed with that, guys.
Well, the best piece is when we went out there and we had somebody teach you. And it's a funny story because I was trying to explain how to get on the bike, how to do some certain things on it. And when you went out there and we paid somebody to teach you, I was standing back. He was saying the same thing I was. But I guess, as you say, you hear it differently, you know, so I knew better.
Yeah. And I think that goes for anything that we're trying to learn, that we'll have different teachers. They might be saying the same thing, but when we're ready to sort of go through that obstacle. And it was actually super tough what I was learning. It was these switchbacks and it was really tight. So it takes lots of skill.
Yeah.
And I think one of the reasons that it hit that time is because I had done the time on the trail to do easier switchbacks. So it wasn't that your guidance is not on point, because you are actually a really good teacher. It was that I just wasn't ready, maybe. But there is something that I want to mention and share with everyone, because if you're new to the podcast, you probably haven't heard the origin story. You know, that little piece of paper that David talked about that he was there for. We were actually sitting in a hotel lobby waiting for Josh to fly in from college at the time when he was at West Point. And I had probably been about a year into the passageway, right? The liminal space into a new beginning. You know, in this evolution of our identity, I've been playing around with this concept of when we're babies, first there's birth, then there's growth, then there's death. But as we evolve our identities, I'm starting to see it more of there's a period of grieving, of death, of loss. And that's a major piece of moving into another identity. Then the growth, and you grow yourself into that rebirth. But anyway, side topic, I had personally been through that process. And that's when I heard without words, those words, love being human. And they were born once I wrote them down on that piece of paper.
Not a piece of paper, it was a napkin.
It was a napkin.
It was a napkin. And I think that was the coolest thing, because I was able to grab that napkin and I was able to blow it up and put it on a picture.
You did, yeah. Thank you for that. Like what you just mentioned, I want to sort of talk about that a little bit. Yes, you stood back in order for me to grow the podcast and do what I needed to do, but you supported me behind the scenes. And I think that it was easier for you to support me once I had made the commitment and once I was definitive on, this isn't something that I want to do, it's something that I have to do. Do you remember those early days?
I do. I just laugh because I'm already going forward where, you know, I already have different things in my mind where, you know, we did the podcast. Now, I don't know if you told your group, but I'm waiting for the book.
The book is coming.
And once that book comes out, and I can't recall the briefing or the class that we went to or where it was a husband and wife, and she gave her conference lecture, and I just remembered keying in on her husband. He had a suit on, he was in the back, and he had the table, and he had the books laid out front. Thought that was the coolest thing, because I envisioned myself, I can't wait for that moment. I'll be in the back trying to, you know, get your autograph for other people to get their book.
Awesome. So that is, we're claiming that vision. That's going to happen eventually. The book is coming. If you have not joined the book list, there's a list on the website where you can add your email and your name and get updates, irregular, occasional updates. So you can get a behind the scenes as a book comes to life. So yes, that will happen. And actually that leads me to my next point. One of the things that I see, because it's easy for me to see you transition and it seems easier in my mind for you. And I was thinking about that. The reason I think that it's easier is because you do time on the trails. Like you have a full commitment and then you do the frequency, you get out there. I think the difference between the way that you embody a new identity, you know, like becoming a mountain biker, and the way that I do, like becoming a podcaster, isn't so much about frequency, because I find myself often having dry spells, right? Like stops and starts. But I do have persistence. Like you said, I've been at it 6 years. What's your opinion of the difference that we move through that transition or that change and how we work towards things?
I think we constantly have to challenge ourselves, you know, hold ourselves to a higher standard. And, you know, I might be riding the same trail, you know, but I kind of glanced down at my watch and I was like, okay, so I know I did it in 32 last time. You know, maybe I can do it in 30. I can do it in 28 or something. So, I mean, it's just that constantly I feel like, you know, I got to have that, you know, just to hold myself accountable. Or, you know, some days you just want to go out there and just chill and have a nice ride. You know, it's just challenging, you know, just kind of keeping it going, trying different changes, trails. So to me, it's like, I couldn't imagine this past year, you know, riding trails in Oregon, Colorado. They're all different. So what's made me feel a better rider is, you know, just consistently riding and challenging myself to those different trails.
Yeah, you're really great about frequency. And I think I'm better with persistence, just the resolve to keep going until I get it done. Different strokes for different folks, right? One of the things that I wanted to mention to you as the audience, if you are moving through a transition, that there's often a squat before there's a leap. Like imagine yourself squatting down to jump. So was there a period, David, for you when you were beginning to ride bikes and forming this identity of being a mountain biker that felt hard or slower to see progress?
Yeah, and it goes back to that military concept. We have a thing that's the crawl, you know, crawl, walk, run phase. And, you know, get on a bike, just making sure this is something I like doing, you know, and it's like, okay. And, you know, I remember picking up a bike from a yard sale. And what I love, you know, is passing on what I've learned from the beginning, you know, getting the right equipment, not getting that equipment, trying to save some money, offering my advice to other people. Definitely just kind of taking it slow, you know, and then checking yourself along the way before you can take that next leap.
I don't see you taking things slow. I think they happen pretty fast for you. One of the things that has happened, like you have your YouTube channel, you've gotten some sponsorships, you know, people with merch and that sort of thing. And I also see you, you know, from what I see, right, from where I sit, that you've become a part of the community. Like people recognize you on the trail, people reach out to you, you know, so how did that happen?
You know, that itself, what you just said is, you can't even describe that feeling, you know, getting people on the right bikes, you know, just kind of talking to them, you know, offering advice. I can be out there and some kids are trying to fix their bike. And I said, hey, do you need this? And they'll look at me and kind of laugh. And they're like, yeah, do you have that? But it's a tight community in the mountain bike community. You know, we're all riding bikes. You know, we got some adrenaline guys that are out there just, you know, hitting the trails. But I mean, to me, it's just that satisfying feeling of, hey, do you need help? You know, or just so I can offer, you know, a tool. Hey, this equipment's working great for me. So it's, as they say, it's not always about the green, but it's just getting that wow, that feeling, you know, people asking for advice or help.
Yeah, and I think they do that because they see that you are open to helping and that you do share what you learn and how you learn it as much as you can. And there's been a lot of learning over the last year. Would you agree?
I totally agree. I am not mechanically inclined, but I took that, you know, that mentality of, hey, I really like riding bikes. And, you know, so you have a piece of equipment, you take it into the store, the guy looks at it and he just tweaks it a little bit and he says, hey, that's 40, 50 bucks. And I was like, hold on. So that's, you know, something that I decided I want to be the guy that's doing the little tweaking and doing that and, you know, just kind of passing that off.
Yeah, that squat before you leap, you know, thinking you couldn't do it and then you did do it.
Here we go.
One of the things that, you know, because this podcast is about navigating change, and there's one thing that we can count on in life, right, is things changing on the outside. When things change on the outside and you're ready internally, then it's going to create a transformation inside. One of the things, and this is a bit of a pivot, but I got to take advantage of having you on the mic. So we've been married a few decades, and over the course of 20 of those years, you were active duty military. And there's a, you know, I often tell people when I'm talking about our relationship and our marriage that every time you came back from a deployment, you were a different person in a different way. And you and I both, and you alluded to it with the podcast and with what I've been doing the last 6 years, but we have given each other enough space so that we can grow into that next evolution of ourselves. So I noticed that's one of the things that you're just good at, you know, taking experiences on the outside, internalizing them, and then allowing them to make you better. What do you see from that?
Well, every time like being away from my family or deployed or, you know, sitting out there 10 months, to me, it was just time that I didn't have, that I didn't spend with the boys or you. So when you come back, you're just, you know, you kind of want to have those moments where you're like, you know, I need to make the most of it. I need to keep going forward. Or, you know, that year being deployed, coming back, you know, you just can't control things when you're away like that, especially in that type of, you know, environment. It just gave me more of a appreciation of life. You know, this is what's given to you. So, you know, make the most, and kind of leads me to that little hashtag I always use, live your life. You just never know. So when I'm hitting that trail, we never say, hey, we're going to one more ride, you know, one last ride. We never say that because that's when something happens. So we either just, you know, hey, we'll hit it again tomorrow or something. But definitely just being more appreciative of my surroundings and coming back. And then the other part is just seeing how hard work, everything that you did while I was gone. I was like, man, I don't know. I think it was harder here.
I'm not going to disagree with that, but I'm kidding. Deployments, everybody, you know, every situation has its own pros and cons. I mean, I was the one with the kids when they were kids because they're grown men now.
Yeah. When I got back one deployment, I remember one of the boys, I'm not going to tell you which one, he would just happen to be peeing sitting down.
Oh, really?
So I was like, hey, we need to change this. So we went out and got the Fruit Loops or the Cheerios, and I said, hey, we're going to change this up. And it was just kind of funny. Just a quick story there.
I don't know if they'll appreciate that being on the air, you know, for hundreds and thousands of downloads. But one of the things, you know, there's another pivot. Like, there's evolution in our identity, like what people see us on the outside and how we see ourselves. Like, I see myself as a podcaster now. You know, over the last year, you've become a mountain biker. The evolutions in identity and still looking the same outside, but being different people within our marriage, like 3 decades. We're not the same people we were at 18 or 38, you know. And then you just mentioned another transition that I think is important. So this is the all-in podcast right now. This is the episode that talks about everything. Another transition that we have to navigate, us personally, and I think a lot of people that may be listening, is mentally allowing the growth of our children into adults. Like, you just called them boys. We use the word kids, but in reality, they are both grown men. Like, what would you say to other parents who haven't raised their children already? And I know that, so here's what I'm trying to get at. I really make a consistent effort to navigate that change, to call them men, to not think of them nostalgically, as nobody knows more than me how much I loved the ages, you know, all the ages. I loved being a mother, but being a mother of grown men is different.
I totally agree, especially with their ages now where, you know, I've been their father, been their mentor, and now it's like they're my best friends. So it's just that little pivot thing where, yeah, you know, the respect, yo, that's my father, but yet, you know, we're out there hitting the trails and we're doing riding bikes. We're like, hey, you know, check this out. And, you know, so, you know, we're best buds. Just, you got to be honest with them. You know, you hold them accountable and don't lie to them because they'll see right through it. You know, these guys, or as you say, these men will. But also, and it's pretty cool because I think I heard Josh had said something to you the other day where he's like, dad was just talking to me about something. So even our discussions have kind of like, hey, what do you think about this, Josh or Jake? You know, so I respect their opinions as well. And it's never been one way, you know, early on. Yeah, as a father, it's like, hey, do this because this is, you know, what's got to get done. But now I'm like, hey, so right now I'm living the life. Boys are out there with me. We're out there running. We're out there riding bikes. And like I say, this past year, there's certain trails that I wouldn't even thought about riding if I didn't have Josh with me riding, you know. I mean, you know, he doesn't like when I'm in the front and I'm leading.
Oh, really?
You know, you just hold him accountable. Also, you got to, you know, let them sort of fail so they can kind of, we'll be there. But yeah, this is great.
Yeah. And what I hear you saying is that is not a one-way street, that you give them room, you know, to give you advice and to give share their opinions with you. So maybe that's what contributes in a way to there being the respect of a father and a mentor, but also the camaraderie of a friendship.
Absolutely.
And actually, you guys have a connection because you served and both of them have served too.
Oh, yeah. No. You know, both of them have. And I remember those deep conversations. You know, Jake, I got to tell the funny story.
Which one is this?
Yeah, I know. So, you know, Josh, as he went up to the academy up in New York and, you know, he graduated from West Point. And along the way, Jake's a senior. And, you know, he gave me some great, I want to say, some West Texas state championship football. And it was just like, hey, is this something you're going to want to continue? Or, and, you know, he just said, no, I want to go to school, but also want to serve. And I said, okay. So we took him up to West Point. And he walked around and, you know, he looked at stuff and he came back and he says, nope, this isn't for me. He says, I want to go back to college. He says, I want to join a frat. and I want to be able to drink beer.
He said those exact words.
Well, I'm ad-libbed the drink part, but, you know, and I said, okay, you know, we'll get this figured out. And then, you know, along the way, he said, hey, but I do want to serve. You know, Grandpa served, you served, Josh served. And, you know, so we got him into the National Guard. And let me tell you, I mean, I'm looking at a sign outside the house that says 2020 graduate, you know, so I know it's been a long journey for Jake. Off the bat, graduating high school, you know, going to basic training, coming back. So he was down one semester when his traditional group kept going forward. I think midway, he got called up for the hurricane support. So that was another semester that he was out. So when you put two semesters, he was out a year. So now he's graduating, but he kept going forward.
He did. And as a mother, it wasn't easy for me to see him make that choice, because not only did I support them obviously serving, but Jacob wanted to go all in, and he was a
scout reconnaissance.
19 Delta?
Yeah, it was a Cav Scout. So
it's called crazy is what it is.
And so, yeah, he comes home with his, I said, hey, what job did you get? And he's like, you know, Vivian's thinking he's going to be,
I don't know, librarian, I don't, anything.
Yeah, librarian, right? So then I said, take a breath. And I said, let me see if I can go in there and soft sell it to your mom and let her know. And the first words were, and you let him do this?
Yeah, 19 Delta wasn't easy to swallow. Their training is being in front of the infantry.
Yeah, being dropped across enemy lines and providing reconnaissance. And
yeah, that sounds even better.
I've said too much.
Yes, you have. Okay, so we need to transition at this point.
Okay.
No more Army talk.
No, that's gone.
Well, you know, you mentioned Jake and his football career, and it was a big part. So maybe we can, we've never had this conversation before, so it'll be interesting to hear it from your side. But one of the things I noticed even about Jake is that he transitions identities in the same way you do. When he, I mean, being a football player and being a football player in West Texas, you know, with what, 4 or 5 or 6, how many do they have, like 10 back-to-back state championships now?
Yep.
He had the ring, he had the, you know, Letterman jacket, he had, you know, the whole camaraderie around that. And as soon as high school was over, that identity left with it. He's never, like, put that jacket back on. He's not the kind of person who, like, reminisces about the old days. Well, what's your opinion of that?
I think, once again, it's that going forward, you know, holding yourself accountable, saying, hey, I need a, that's great, you know, for me. I was loving it and, you know, reliving it. But Jake, he was ready to go, you know, get in school and trying to figure this out. But good point. It was a, you know, transition for him, but Jake being Jake.
Well, you and Jake, you guys have a real talent around that. One of the metaphors, the mind pictures that came up as you were talking is, you know, both of you guys are really good drivers. Josh, you're a good driver too. All y'all are good drivers. But is the idea of you guys spending most of your focus and attention when you're on the road, looking forward, right, where you're going and what's surrounding you, and less time looking in the rearview mirror. And that's kind of how I translate the way that you and Jacob move through your transitions and your identities, is you focus a lot more time moving forward than looking back in the rearview mirror.
And I think, you know, driving as well, when I'm behind the wheel and I have passengers, I'm like, hey, they're entrusting me with their safety to get them from point A to point B. So I kind of look at that as well through my transitions. And it's just like the mountain biking thing. Here we go again, you know, getting you on there. First thing I was like, nope, you need a helmet. You need knee braces. I mean, you need protection, because, you know, I want you to have fun, but I also want you to be safe doing it as well.
Perfect. So, David, if there are young military families that are listening to this, or there's a soldier who is about to retire and they're kind of scared about that transition of leaving that society, because it is a bubble within a society, it's a completely different culture. Based on your experiences, what kind of advice or guidance or tips would you share about that transition for them?
I would say start preparing now. Don't be scared. And I think that was one of the things that you brought to the table, was helping us, you know, with that transition, as far as, you know, the family, the financial, it's going to be all right if you're not wearing the uniform. You know, there is life after that. But also looking at your careers, you know, one day we're stationed in Fort Hood. Hey, we're leaving to Germany. Hey, we're going to Virginia. So I was the one uprooting you along the way, but also seeing like, hey, this can be done, you know, and it's hard, but definitely it can be done. So, you know, in that financial thing, I know it's hard, you know, especially in a time right now, is one of the abilities that you said, hey, don't ever let the paycheck control you. And that was hard for me, because I, being the provider, we had to put food on the table and survive, bills, everybody's got bills. But that was one thing where you build up your little nest egg, and it gave you that flexibility saying, hey, we're going to be all right. You know, we got a 4 to 6 month, you know, time frame. So that really kind of helped me out. So definitely prepare. And there is life after the military. Trust me.
Is it better than you imagine?
It's still going.
Yeah. One of the things for me when you talked about, so now we're getting into the whole bit about career transition, and I'll leave this little jewel or nugget because we touched on it. I did transition, you know, a lot of time throughout my career. What I'm doing now, I consider my vocation, which like it's meaningful at all sorts of levels. It's what I feel like I'm meant to do. But in reality, the thread of what I'm doing goes all the way back. I remember in the early 2000s, right when we got back from Germany, 97 maybe, 96, and I was working with soldiers transitioning out of the military and with military wives in their careers as they were transitioning in. So the idea of transition and navigating change, we both lived it in those decades, you know, while you were active duty. And I feel like what I'm doing now is just a bigger echo, right? An ecosystem of that thread that's kind of gone on for the last 30 decades. 30, not 33. Three or four, however long, because I'm not good at math. However long from mid to late 90s to present is. That seed, that nugget of helping people move through change has always been with me, even though the jobs, the titles, and the locations have changed. So it's nice to also, in addition to looking forward and focusing your attention on moving forward the way that you do, David, I think for me, it's meaningful to also look back and see how all those dots connect.
Absolutely. You know, it's that whole never forget where you came from type of mentality. You know, titles and positions will come and go.
But one of the things, and here I'm going to challenge you a little bit about that, because never forgetting what you come from, like our culture, our the way that we're raised, it does travel with us.
Absolutely.
But I think that we do have to, in a way, put aside what we've been taught and how we've been raised. Because in my opinion, like we don't let go of those rituals and those anchors to our identity, like what we do, like the things that we do every year as a family that bring us together. But we've had to let go a lot of, I think, beliefs that we might have had when we were younger that really don't apply to us. I mean, part of that is, I mean, me growing up, neither of my parents had finished high school. And, you know, I was living in the projects for a part of my youth. And when we moved into this house, this was a tough transition for me. So I feel like in that way. So what's your opinion of that? Like, I think we bring forward what's beautiful about our culture and what's beautiful about our lives and our traditions. But there's some things that we do have to let go of.
Oh, I totally agree. You do let go. So I guess when I say you don't forget, you know, it's there. But also process for me is, you know, I've got the kids. I got the boys. I got the men. You know, how do I wish my parents would have been with me or my relationship with my father? So I always kind of flip it, you know, like, hey, this is what I would have wanted or this is what I expected. And then in return, that's what I try to apply with them. Try to fill that void because to me, the reminder is like, okay, so if my dad didn't do this, do that, that didn't make me feel good. Or how did that impact me? Well, let me not do that for the boys, for the guys.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, reminder, yes, but grow from it and move on. Build, make it better. Always building.
I like that. So focus on moving forward and keep building.
Absolutely.
So that you can continue to grow. And that's one thing that I think you and I both are on the same sheet of music, you know, have the same like core beliefs around is that there we believe that the growth, like we will always grow. Like it doesn't end at an age. It doesn't end at a status. It doesn't end at a you know, certain number in the checkbook. It's I believe. I mean, this is what I believe about us. Tell me if I'm wrong.
Oh, I will.
That we'll continue to grow in hobbies, in learning. Like, that's just what all humans are, like, driven to grow, to move forward in some way.
Well, it's like, you know, I said, hey, all I want to do is just ride bikes. Okay. And then all of a sudden, well, I want to do a little bit more than ride bikes. I want to learn about them. I want to grow. I want to fix them. So definitely, yeah, you know, so now, okay, what's next now?
Leading groups.
Yeah, that's exactly. So Vivian finally let me have my little area in the garage. And it's the coolest thing when you have a neighborhood kids come up and say, hey, mister, are you the bike guy? Can you look at my bike and, you know, kind of fix it? And it's just, like I say, it's going back to that, you know, that feeling like, yeah, I got you, you know?
Yeah, that, I really do respect that about you. You've been able to embody, completely own this identity. And it really shows in the community you've built and people seeing you as that is who you are. And then you building your skills. So I really applaud you for that because I was sort of joking once, David, gets offered jobs and he gets referrals by word of mouth. And I'm like, how do you do that? Like, I want that to happen for my work. And in reality, it does. It just doesn't happen as often and as in my face as it does for David. So I really respect how you've owned this identity and how much you're giving back to the community, and just really how you put on that new pair of that new suit. Maybe it's not a BDU, right?
Right.
What are those suits called that mountain bikers wear?
It depends on it depends on what type of trails you're trying to ride. But yeah,
is it a jersey?
Yeah, they're jerseys or, you know, just, you know, pants and stuff.
In his mind, I'm sure he's thinking of all the different kinds of rides and different types of, yeah, it's a jersey. Put on your bike jersey.
Okay.
This has actually been fun.
Has it? No, this has been great. And like I say, you know, I know it's been way too long and, you know, you brought it up here a couple times and, you know, just not being nervous and just coming out and just doing this. And
being yourself.
Yeah, this is awesome.
I think you're pretty cool.
The feeling's mutual.
I would hope so. Well, so if somebody's interested in learning more about dirt biking, mountain biking, no, it's mountain biking, right?
Yes.
I'm sorry. Mountain biking.
Or just bikes in general.
Or just bikes in general. How do they find you?
They can hit me up and on my channel, my Insta. I got Dave Behind the Bar, and I've got my YouTube channel, which is DC Productions.
What do you do on your YouTube channel?
This is pretty good. I'm learning a lot. You know, I can talk, but I think with that type of platform, I'm able to reach out a lot more people. So my better get in now when you can. You know, you always hear that, hey, subscribe now. But I think my thing is doing product reviews, kind of sharing my experiences, talking about certain trails. You know, I just told you today I wanted to actually do a video on knee braces, because I've been seeing a lot of riders out there in the trails and they don't even have any protection, and you know, next you know, something happens. So we've got like 10-12 pairs.
Oh my gosh, you said we had every brand that exists.
Well, I mean, different protection levels.
So product reviews.
Yeah, just product reviews. And the other thing is just doing some quick tutorial videos. You'll be amazed. Somebody hits me up and said, hey, can you help me out? Change a flat. Explain it to me. And I'm like, absolutely. Let me show you some quick tips on how to do that.
Perfect. You guys, if you're interested in following David and his adventures on the trail, then hit the subscribe button on DC Productions on YouTube.
Correct.
So what has been your favorite trail so far?
I like going up to Mount Ashland to Oregon. That's just, you know, it's just an amazing trip. I know we did it. I did it twice, you know, one last year. And then this year, you know, after riding it the second time, it's not as scary. The first time I remember getting off that trail, first thing I did was call you when I got down from downhill. And, you know, after I go back and think about it, I'm like, what did I just do?
Right.
So riding it the second time, I was able to take it in and not, you know, within a year, your skill level, you know, gets better. So, or it should, but wasn't scared. I was able to enjoy it, and especially I was able to do it with both my boys.
Yeah, I enjoyed that too, even though I didn't take the downhills.
Right.
That was good. So Mount Ashland is your favorite downhill?
Yeah, as of right now.
As of right now.
Yeah, because we're...
There's always an adventure on the horizon.
Exactly. Not settling, remember?
The grass does not grow under our feet, I've heard people say.
Have your bags ready.
Well, it has been an absolute joy to interview you. Thank you for joining me on the mic. This is my first in real life interview with the hardest guest it's been to book, my own husband, David Carrasco. I'd really want to thank you for listening, sharing a little bit of our lives and David's journey to becoming a mountain biker. And I hope that it adds value to your own journey as you're maybe navigating change or uncertainty or confusion. And one of the things I want to reflect back on that I briefly mentioned as we were talking is the squat before you jump. You know, just if you happen to be in the dip, you know, if you're squatting for that leap, then recognize that that's where you are and look forward to what's next. You know, maybe take some tips either from David or from me, depending on where your experience is. But always remember that you are your own best teacher and that there is no way to navigate this change without actually going through it. So you don't learn how to ride a bike by reading about it on books, right?
Right.
You got to get on the trail.
Get on the trail. Get out there.
Get out there. So that's kind of where I want to close. If you're moving towards some identity that you want to become, whether it's becoming a writer or a teacher or whatever identity you're about to try on, like get out there and do it. That's the best I want to say advice that we have to give you.
Yeah.
I mean, it has to be embodied. Your body has to experience in order for your brain to believe it. So thank you again for joining me on the Within You podcast.